I joined the wood turning club even before I had turned any wood, and I did not own a lathe or any equipment. I had had one semester of pottery in college. It was kind of a throwaway one-hour course. That made me familiar with the forms that are natural in spinning clay or turning wood. So I thought that sounded kind of interesting. I bought a small lathe at a garage sale, and it was just enough that I really decided that, yeah, I could do this, but I knew that there was an easier way. I was struggling because I needed more training. I started wood turning in my garage, so every time I turned and created dust and sawdust, the furnace picked it up and spread that dust throughout the house. So the first opportunity that I had to build a shop, I had a lot of support from my wife to get out of the garage. It's amazing that a wife will put up with a wood turner. She raised three children, ran the household, and complained about my tracking in wood chips and sawdust, but still has encouraged me and shown an interest and been very supportive of what I've been doing.
Well, when he first started wood turning, I was surprised. I mean, I knew he was talented in art. I never thought anything that he would do like this. Painting, yes, but not woodworking. He turned out pretty good, so except for the mess he makes every once in a while, it's, you know, I don't mind it. I think he does a good job.
The piece that I'm working on now, the feature being a series of paintings of the Monet gardens that he was famous for painting. I get my inspiration from my background. I'm a retired architect, and after I started turning, I tried to incorporate some of what I've learned as an architect. Last year, I turned 80 years old. I developed some arthritis in my hands, and particularly my thumb. I decided to take some watercolor lessons. I'm doing it primarily for my own satisfaction and to see if I can learn how to do it. I've been telling everyone that if I keep taking watercolor lessons for maybe another 20 years, I'll have this thing pretty well figured out. Well, the challenges have always been the chase for perfection. You'll never get there. But if you don't pursue it and give the best effort in the shapes and the finishes, it's just another exercise. I'm not sure that I've ever actually set a goal other than feeling that my work was good enough to show to other people and be recognized as a decent wood turner.
Turning point when I was 8 years old. I had polio, and I was very fortunate to have a fairly light case. I couldn't walk for a while, and I couldn't turn my head for a while, but I was one of the blessed few who were able to get past that and didn't have permanent damage. I'd always been drawing and everything, and I knew then that I wanted to be an artist. My particular kind of art, wildlife art, can bring the outdoors inside. And if you're someone who loves the outdoors as well, but you want a roof over your head and you want nice things in your home, then a nice painting can also add beauty and liveliness to your home. People can relate to what they see. They'll have a response to what they see on a canvas. When I take my own photographs for reference, I do drawings, and I may do several drawings on tracing paper, actually. And then I think about my color, and then come up with a finished composition. I look at life as a continuum of learning. You should always be learning. That's just my own philosophy. Even Monet said in his old age that he thought he knew even less about painting as he got older than he did when he was young. But part of the reason is that you question what you do.
as you get older and how you do it.
After my husband and I were married and I was pursuing a career as an artist, and we had two young children, and so life was pretty hectic because I was working full-time at my art as well. And I had done a show and I hadn't sold anything. I was so depressed. When I got home, he had purchased a cheap easel from a garage sale for me, but his timing couldn't have been better because it inspired me to keep going. My business had grown enough that, you know, it was either take a giant leap of faith or not. And we chose, fortunately, to take the giant leap of faith and build on this wonderful studio. Most people give up too early. And if you can talk to yourself and convince yourself not to give up, to keep trying, try one more time, then you will succeed.
There's this really old quote, and I wish I knew who said it first, but it really applies to me. Art is like breathing. If I don't do it for a while, I turn blue and fall down. The first time I really thought about being an artist is when my parents took me to Gilcrease Museum, and I was just stunned. And so then I started doodling, and that's when things got crazy. My entire family is engineers, all scientists. So they thought I was a little wacky when I said I wanted to do art. But they love me anyway, so it's all good, right? When I first left high school and went off to college, I thought I was going to be an educator, and that's what I started. And then a whole series of events happened, and I didn't finish college the first time, and I got married, and I moved off, and basically took what jobs were available, and I started out as fast order cook, and then I was a truck driver for a while. And then I got in at the lowest level of computing, and I worked up from there taking night classes into geophysical research. And I was always doing art on the side, but the real paycheck was in research. There's never been anyone in the world more supportive than my husband. When our careers in the oil business went and we had to reinvent ourselves, his response was, here is an opportunity to go so much further with your art than you've ever gone before. He believes in me more than I do. How can you not be inspired by someone like that? I get into still life and landscapes and pretty much anything on the side of lots of light and lots of color. I love to play with things that, you know, the sun is shining through something, or it's putting amazing shadows or sparkles through something. It's, how do I capture that moment? Probably the most rewarding part of art is sharing with people. I mean, when I see this really magical moment when the sunshine hits the colors in this one spot, and I can somehow grab that feeling and share it with you, that's the best thing ever.
I started becoming an artist as an adult because as a child, I'm not one of these people that say, oh, I drew all my life. I'm not. I was the poster child of a bored housewife when I took my first art lesson. I don't paint every day. I think if I did, then it would become routine or a job. I don't want it to be a job. I want to come in here and paint what I want to paint when I want to paint it. The different mediums that I work in are oil, watercolor, and acrylic. I also travel with a sketchbook, and that's when I do most of my pen and ink sketches. And then acrylics, I get in here in my studio and I fling acrylic around and I do just crazy fun stuff. Depends on how the painting is going as to how I feel when I'm painting. If a painting is going good, I love it. I have music in here and I crank my tunes, and if it's going good, I'm good. If it's not going good, I'll get over it. It'll get better. My life has been fairly uncomplicated up until a few years ago. My husband was diagnosed with COPD and he got seriously, terminally ill. After he passed away, I didn't paint. My studio here sat empty. My brushes dried up. My oil paints, watercolors, they all got to be thrown out. And then a friend of mine suggested that I go and take a workshop with her. So we went and I painted for 5 days, had a ball, and it opened up my heart again. And I think that's why I paint, because it brings me joy, and I do enjoy it. As far as getting ribbons and awards, it's okay, but it's not that important to me. I would rather have somebody come in and say, wow, I love this painting, and that's what makes me feel good.
I grew up in the country, and it was dirt roads and a lot of grass. So after it would rain, then the dust would settle, and all the little fine sand would come to the top on the ground. And I'd go out and sit down and pick up a stick and draw in that dirt, you know. And then from there, I was always drawing something and building something. I think that's where I got headed in the direction of three-dimensional work, that I just love to build stuff. So art's really been a part of my life, all my life. The steer was suggested by my son-in-law. The dog that I'm starting is actually his champion dog that's at the national field trials right now. The little dancing girl is my granddaughter. First thing I do is put it down on paper or get the research material that I'm going to use. And you want to be as original as you can with your ideas. And of course, you know, we all see things that tweak our interest and help us with creating a piece. Then from that, you make your aluminum wire armature, put your clay on it, and once that is done, my part is pretty much over. But during the process, it unfolds, and all of a sudden, you turn it into a marketable piece of work, something that you really are proud that you've done. And there are pieces that I get much more involved with and excited about than others, simply because they're a little more challenging. Everybody grows in their application, their learning process, their vocation, or whatever, but that's the part I enjoy so much, is the learning part and the growth that can occur if you just really like what you're doing.